Along with human activities, natural events are also influencing global climate. But to what extent? Are recent changes Mother Nature's doing? Join us as we explore the influence of natural events on our climate. Let's look first at volcanic eruptions. You may not connect the term aerosols with volcanoes, but these small particles can be introduced to the atmosphere by a volcanic eruption. Eruptions that are large and explosive enough to add significant quantities of aerosols into the upper atmosphere, or stratosphere, create a shroud that reflects some sunlight back to space, thereby cooling the climate. In some cases, such cooling effects can persist for 2 to 3 years after an eruption. If there are multiple eruptions within a few decades, the climate tends to be cooler than in other periods. The last major volcanic eruption to have a global cooling effect was the massive eruption of Mount Pinatubo in the Philippines on June 15, 1991. But not all volcanic eruptions affect climate in this way. There are many others that have devastating results but do not affect the climate because they do not eject material into the stratosphere. Examples of these include the 1980 eruption of Mount St. Helens in Washington State, which affected thousands in the Pacific Northwest and beyond, and the 2010 eruption of Eyjafjallajökull in Iceland that affected air travel worldwide for weeks. But neither of these events led to significant cooling on a global scale. Another natural influence on climate is rooted in the behavior of the ocean. Two names we've all heard because they turn up frequently in the news are El Niño and La Niña. These are two of nature's most powerful weather phenomena. Together, they form a climate oscillation that impacts the tropical Pacific Ocean on roughly 2 to 7 year intervals, with an average of about 5 years. They have a profound effect on the Earth's climate. They are associated with broad-scale warming, El Niño, or cooling, La Niña, of the surface ocean. Trade winds normally blow from east to west along the equator. In the Pacific Ocean, they push water from the Galapagos Islands region of the eastern Pacific all the way to the area near Indonesia. Sea level near Indonesia is several tens of centimeters higher than off Panama because of the trade wind influence. But every 4 to 7 years, on average, the trade winds relax, and the water that has been piled up near Indonesia flows back along the equator and bathes the eastern tropical Pacific area with a thin but very broad area of warm water. This animation compares the intense El Niño of 1997 to the more moderate year of 1982. The red zone indicates very warm water that occupied much of eastern equatorial Pacific Ocean in 1997. That water radiated an enormous amount of heat into the Earth's atmosphere and dramatically changed weather systems around the planet. It released so much heat from the sea over such a large area that 1998 became one of the warmest years on record globally. El Niño events don't last that long, up to 1 or sometimes 2 years. The Earth's climate system readjusts after the peak release of heat and oceanographic conditions switch back toward what would be considered to be the normal state. Colder water wells up to the surface in the eastern equatorial Pacific and occupies much of the region. When that upwelling is particularly strong, the surface ocean in the region becomes even cooler, yielding a La Niña event. 2008, for example, was a cool La Niña year, and as a consequence, the overall global average temperature declined. Taken together, El Niño and La Niña events contribute a significant amount of the year-to-year variability that we see in temperature records. Let's leave Mother Nature's Earth-based influences for now and look upward to the sun. Sunspots are dark, cooler patches on the sun's surface, typically surrounded by hotter circles of brightness called aureoles that result from an intense magnetic activity within the star. On this graph, which shows the behavior of the sun since 1975, sunspot numbers are represented by the blue line, which goes up and down on about an 11-year frequency. This is called the sunspot cycle, and we've known about it since the time of Galileo. When sunspot numbers are high, more solar radiation, or insolation, reaches the Earth because the aureoles around the sunspots are very hot. The irregular yellow line shows the changing amount of solar radiation that has reached the top of Earth's atmosphere. You can see that there is a close correspondence with sunspot numbers. So what has been happening over the last 30 years or so as the Earth has warmed? The output of the Sun has in fact been declining very slightly. We cannot conclude from these data that changes in solar output are responsible for the observed warming of the last four decades. In fact, based on these measurements, and in the absence of other influences, the Earth would actually have slightly cooled since 1980. Now, let's summarize. There are a number of factors other than human activities that affect climate. Ocean atmospheric phenomena, like El Nino and La Nina. Major volcanic eruptions, which inject aerosols into the upper atmosphere and thereby help cool the climate. Variations in the number of sunspots on the Sun, which occur in about 11-year cycles and slightly change the amount of solar radiation that reaches the Earth. But such changes are now known to have only a small effect on climate, and so the idea that recent climate change is all Mother Nature's doing and has nothing to do with us is simply not true.